morning's Old Testament lesson comes from Leviticus 19, verses, I'll read verses 1 through 2, and then 9 through 18. It can be found on page 106 in your pew Bibles. The Lord spoke to me, Moses, saying, "Speak to all the congregation of the people of Israel and say to them, 'You shall be holy, for I, the Lord your God, am holy.' When you reap the harvest of your land, you shall not reap to the very edges of your field or gather the gleanings of your harvest. You shall not strip your vineyard bare or gather the fallen grapes of your vineyard. You shall leave them for the poor and the alien. I am the Lord your God. You shall not steal. You shall not deal falsely, and you shall not lie to one another. And you shall not swear falsely by my name, profaning the name of your God. I am the Lord. You shall not defraud your neighbor. You shall not steal, and you shall not keep for yourself the wages of a laborer until morning. You shall not revile the deaf or put a stumbling block before the blind. You shall fear your God. I am the Lord. You shall not render an unjust judgment. You shall not be partial to the poor or defer to the great. With justice you shall judge your neighbor. You shall not go around as a slanderer among your people, and you shall not profit by the blood of your neighbor. I am the Lord. You shall not hate in your heart any one of your kin. You shall not reprove your neighbor, or you will incur guilt yourself. You shall not take vengeance or bear a grudge against any of your people, for you shall love your neighbor as yourself. I am the Lord." This morning's gospel lesson comes from the book of Luke, chapter 10, verses 25 through 37, and that can be found on page 71. Samaritan. Just then a lawyer stood up to test Jesus. "Teacher," he said, "what must I do to inherit eternal life?" He said to him, "What is written in the law? What do you read there?" He answered, "You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your strength and with all your mind, and your neighbor as yourself." And he said to him, "You have given the right answer. Do this and you will live." But wanting to justify himself, he asked Jesus, "And who is my neighbor?" Jesus replied, "A man was going down from Jerusalem to Jericho and fell into the hands of robbers, who stripped him, beat him, and went away, leaving him half dead. Now by chance, a priest was going down that road, and when he saw him, he passed by on the other side. So likewise, a Levite, when he came to the place and saw him, passed by on the other side. But a Samaritan, while traveling, came near him, and when he saw him, he was moved with pity. He went to him and bandaged his wounds, having poured oil and wine on him. Then he put him on his own animal, brought him to an inn, and took care of him. The next day he took out 2 denarii, gave them to the innkeeper, and said, 'Take care of him, and when I come back, I will repay you whatever more you spend.' Which of these three do you think was a neighbor to the man who fell into the hands of the robbers?" He said, "The one who showed him mercy." Jesus said to him, "Go and do likewise." This morning's epistle reading comes from 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verses 19 and 20. This can be found on page 169. "Glorify God in body and spirit. Or do you not know that your body is a temple of the Holy Spirit within you, which you have from God, and that you are not your own? For you were bought with a price. Therefore, glorify God in your body." The Word of God.
Do you pray with me? Lord God, empty me of all of me and fill me with your Spirit. May the words of my mouth be only yours and not my own. In your name I pray. Amen. A few years ago, a professor, a theologian, in the Old Testament, the New Testament, and the Quran, and comparing them to the Universal United Nations Declaration of Universal Rights. During this activity, one of her students decided to ask her this one question. If she could bring only one of those texts, which one would she choose to start a new civilization on a deserted island? She chose the United Nations Declaration, despite its well-known critiques and its focus on individual rights as opposed to legitimate group values, among its many other critiques. In addition to her answer, she discussed about her love for all of the scriptures. Particularly, she retained a soft spot for each one, despite all of their many difficulties. She believed Jesus' Sermon on the Mount could not have occurred if it weren't for Leviticus 19, from which we read today. Her students were deeply horrified by this response. It took her a little while, but she realized that Leviticus had been routinely used as one of the clobbering texts to damn this sexual deviant to hell. I have been studying Leviticus myself. And like this professor, I have begun to find a deep fondness for Leviticus. Now, this is surprising because for many years now, I have been reading through the Bible. And whenever I get to Leviticus and Numbers, I sort of tune it out. It's a tough read. But this time around, I was surprised to discover this new love for Leviticus. I wasn't shocked when I went to the lectionary to see that they only have Leviticus included one time and Numbers three times. You see, the passage read today from Leviticus is the only one ever written from Leviticus. To top that, some preachers, or you rarely hear preachers, preach on them. Some avoid them because of their being used to oppress people. But, as many of you have figured out as you've gotten to know me over this past year, I am neither ordinary, nor do I like to do what is usual. I love a good challenge. So I decided that today I would preach from Leviticus. Now, there was much I felt I could preach on, and many ideas were rolling through my head. But as I read through today's passage again and again, one thing began to stick out for me. It was in one particular verse 18, which reminds us of the golden rule. You know, the one that says, do unto others as you would have done unto you. It was about being a good neighbor, loving your neighbor as you love yourself. During my study and preparation, I recalled a question proposed by my daughter not too long ago. Now, some of you have also gotten to know my daughter and know that she is a bright young girl and can ask her mama some pretty tough questions, especially when it comes to spiritual questions. And she asks me this, Mom, the Bible says we are to put others before ourselves, but Dad, not Mom, says I should worry about myself and not what others are doing. I know you've heard that phrase. She said, I want to do for them what I would want them to do for me, and that's why I'm helping them. But they always seem to get mad when I help them. Then later on in the week, she pointed to a sign in Wegmans that had Danny Wegman on it, and below it was his quote, which said, never think about yourself. Always help others. Again, she says, it's what we were talking about before. See, even they say it. You see, there is a problem with my daughter's way of viewing this commandment, to seeing this golden rule in only one superficial perspective. The problem with seeing this rule in the way that it was viewed by my daughter and the way it is viewed by many is that the rule only directs us to do what we would do to ourselves. It's based on the desires of people, sinful people. Could a drug addict be following this rule if they shared their drugs with someone else? I know that's an extreme example and sounds ridiculous, but what about the family member or friend of an addict who, with the best of intentions, continues to enable them by providing for them and trying to help the addict even when that person has not asked? Like my daughter had to realize, sometimes when it seems like we are helping, we are not really helping at all. You negate the virtues of self-sacrifice when the fruits of your well-intentioned actions wind up not helping someone and doing more harm than good. Particularly when the recipient is not ready or willing to receive your help. When we are helping in ways that are not beneficial to them, we are not loving our neighbor with this neighborly love God speaks about in this passage. There's a Jewish version of this golden rule, which seems and appears to be more accurate. It says, what is hateful to yourself, do not do to another. But even this phrase is lacking, because what is hateful to me might be quite beneficial to me. For example, and many of you may know this example yourselves, I absolutely hate exercising. Now, I have been told by plenty of people that once you exercise again and again and again, you're going to begin to love it. Well, I've been doing it for many years, and I still don't love it. But it is beneficial to me. Not living a healthy lifestyle is something that can lead to destruction of our physical bodies. But think of all the emotional and spiritual harm we inflict upon ourselves on a regular basis. So now, why would God command us to love our neighbor as ourselves when clearly we get it wrong a lot of the time? Even Jesus reminds us of God's commandment in the Gospel of Matthew in his Sermon on the Mount. And again, in the Luke passage, which was read today. I believe the parable of the Good Samaritan can offer us a clarification on this commandment that Jesus refers to from the Leviticus passage. The story seems so simple. Let me remind you what it says. A man was going down from Jerusalem to Jericho and fell into the hands of robbers, who stripped him, beat him, and went away, leaving him half dead. Now by chance, a priest was going down on that road, and when he saw him, he passed by on the other side. So likewise, a Levite, when he came to the place and saw him, passed by on the other side. But a Samaritan, while traveling, came near to him, and when he saw him, he was moved with pity. He went to him and bandaged his wounds, having poured oil and wine on them. Then he put him on his own animal, brought him to an inn, and took care of him. The next day he took out 2 denarii, gave them to the innkeeper, and said, take care of him, and when I come back, I will repay you whatever more you spend. Because our focus is on the neighbor, and our empathy is focused on this wounded individual, we often miss the important underlying message that Jesus offers here. The Samaritan never stops his journey. He doesn't forget that he has a task at hand. He doesn't stop to help. He does stop to help, but he does also extend his care and financial care, but then continues on his own personal journey. He doesn't stop his entire life, never getting back to it. He stays focused. I believe Jesus is reminding us that to love our neighbors as ourselves means we need to love ourselves. If we do not know how to love ourselves, how can we love our neighbors as God is teaching us? If we learn to love ourselves by God's ways as directed in Scripture, then love for our neighbor can become easier. In the opening of Leviticus passage read today, God commands that we be holy as God is holy. There are several commandments that you heard, most of what you heard read, that follow this passage. Let me break them down for you. Verse 9 to 10 deal with harvesting the land and compassion for the poor. 11 and 12 are concerned with the welfare of the community that must not be compromised by dishonesty. Verses 13 and 14 rejects oppression of any kind. Verses 15 and 16 are associated with economic justice. 17 and 18 rejects hate and vengeance. 20 and 22 deal with abusive sexual practices. 26 is concerned with the integrity of the human body. And finally, 32 to 33 is concerned with disrespect for elders and foreigners. But the theme that pervades these verses that are about holy living is the relation to how we treat God and all of God's creation, including ourselves and our neighbors. Chapter 19 is not like the first 18 chapters of Leviticus, which were focused on the priestly rituals. Chapter 18 begins the focus on what God's people should be doing. In order to be holy, as God is holy, we must be concerned with all of creation. So to answer the question, how do we love our neighbor as ourselves? Well, we begin by following the Samaritan's lead and loving ourselves in a holy manner. I've been taught about loving myself in a holy way. The phrase self-care has been a theme over my cancer journey. I had to learn about what it meant to love myself in a holy manner. See, before all of this, I thought I was following the commandment that God gave. I thought I was following the golden rule taught to me as a child. I was doing for others and putting myself last. Then one day, I found myself frustrated, depressed, overweight, spiritually, physically, and mentally drained, and with a cancer diagnosis looming over my head. I missed Jesus' message. I missed his point. The point that God's commanding of loving myself because I, too, was God's creation. I finally came to realize that if I was going to love others, I had to love myself. And I had to learn to love myself in a holy way. I now have a greater understanding of God, which comes with more energy and more skills to love my neighbor as myself. And self-care is evidenced in the Bible in so many places. Our greatest example can be found in the book of Genesis. Thus the heavens and the earth were finished, and all their multitude, the seventh day, God finished the work he had done, and he rested on the seventh day from all the work he had done. So God blessed the seventh day and hallowed it, because on it, God rested from all the work that he had done in creation. God was concerned with self-care, even from the beginning. The importance of rest and rejuvenation was vital and commanded by God and done by God. In fact, he hallowed this time, which is another way of saying he made it holy. He designated that time as holy. Now, rest looks different for different people. Some people find getting to others with others and having conversation very restful. Many others need to retreat to a quiet place to find rest. And yet some even come to worship to find rest. Now rest can happen in many other ways than the three ways I've mentioned. But the point is, we need to find rest and rejuvenation to be holy as God is holy. Genesis 2 is not our only example that occurs in the Bible. In fact, our next greatest example comes from Jesus. Jesus also participated in self-care. In Luke 5 says this, "But now more than ever, the word about Jesus spread abroad. Many crowds would gather to hear him and to be cured of their disease, but he would withdraw to deserted places and pray." Jesus retreated and prayed. Now, this is not the only time that we hear of Jesus retreating and praying. In fact, in amongst the Gospels, it happens 10 times. Jesus needed rest and rejuvenation, and he knew that to be holy as God is holy, he needed to be restful. In fact, he also reminds his disciples the importance of self-care in Mark 6, which reads this, "The apostles gathered around Jesus and told him all that they had done and taught. He said to them, 'Come away to a deserted place all by yourselves and rest a while.' For many were coming and going, and they had no leisure even to eat. And they went away in the boat to a deserted place by themselves." There are even more examples in scriptures, and one of my favorite comes from one of my favorite characters in the Bible, Moses. Moses, in Exodus, reads this. "The next day, Moses sat at the judge for the people, while the people stood around him from morning until evening. When Moses' father-in-law saw all that he was doing for the people, he said, 'What is this that you are doing for the people? Why do you sit alone while all the people stand around you from morning until evening?' Moses said to his father-in-law, 'Because the people come to me to inquire of God. When they have a dispute, they come to me, and I decide between one person and another, and I make known to them the statutes and instructions of God.' Moses' father-in-law said to him, 'What you are doing is not good. You will surely wear yourself out, both you and these people with you, for the task is too heavy for you. You cannot do it alone. Now listen to me. I will give you counsel, and God will be with you. You should represent the people before God, and you should bring their cases before God. Teach them the statutes and instructions and make them known in the way they are to go and the things they are to do. But you should also look for able men among all the people, men who fear God, who are trustworthy and hate dishonest gain. Set such men over them as officers of thousands, hundreds, fifties, and tens. Let them sit as judges for the people at all times. Let them bring every important case to you, but decide every minor case themselves. So it will be easier for you, and they will bear the burden for you. If you do this, and God so commands you to do, then you will be able to endure, and all these people will go to their homes in peace. Moses thought he was doing what God commanded him, to instruct the people, to make decisions about their disagreements, to teach him what God's judgment is. But he forgot another commandment of God, the commandment to care for himself and find rest. His father-in-law, and sometimes it takes our in-laws, even though they may not be so pleasant, to point that out to us. To point it out to us that we are working ourselves too hard. They are acting as a good neighbor. But even Paul reminds us in the Corinthians passage read today to take care of our bodies. Do you not know that your body is a temple of the Holy Spirit within you, which you have from God, and that you are not your own, for you were bought with a price? Therefore, glorify God in your body. I could go on with scripture reference after scripture reference, but I think you get the point. I think it's clear. To love our neighbors as ourselves means loving ourselves in a holy, scriptural way. We are called to be holy as God is holy, and in scriptures, Jesus sums it up perfectly. Jesus reminds us that being holy means following the greatest commandment, to love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, and mind, and likewise, to love your neighbor as yourself in a scripturally holy way.